Trigger warning. This video contains talk of suicide. If you need help, please contact your local helpline. Remember the show when? Remember that weird character from? Remember that commercial where? Nostalgia is defined by Merriam-Webster as a wistful or excessively sentimental yearning for return to or some past period or irrecoverable condition. And although I am sentimental about some parts of my childhood, some I only remember fragments of. Some of the shows I talk about today for 89 Baby are just flashes in the back of my brain from a long time ago. I don't really feel nostalgia for these things, I just remember them. I call this feeling remember-stalgia. And if you think I just made that word up, you're right. Thanks for being here for episode 2 of our look back at the 90s and some 2000s Canadian child stars and shows. I'm going to skip the intro and the nostalgia spiel about my childhood because we covered that in episode 1 and this is episode 2. You can find the link for episode 1 somewhere around here, and if not, it'll be in the description. Funny enough, I found an old VHS where I was watching random shows in what looked like spring 1996 when a lot of the shows we're talking about today were airing. I'll add some of the highlights at the end of this video. The actors and shows I chose for episode 2 are more broadly spread throughout the 90s, so I would say this is an overall 90s Canadian childhood retrospective, encompassing the whole decade of the 90s, and just a bit of the start of the 2000s. Just the tip. Some of the 90s stars require a ton of research because they're nowhere online or they passed away and there's no information on what happened. Tracking down some obscure made-for-TV films or backstage videos of stage productions was not easy. The majority of the actors in my last video stopped acting in the mid-2000s, so the internet was out and they are easier to find, but some of these actors from the 90s, they fell into obscurity by the turn of the millennium, and that 10-year difference has a massive effect on their online footprint. So part of what my goal involves is creating a place that people can see a comprehensive background on some of these lesser-known actors from their childhood with research video to match. It almost feels like they're trapped in the past and I'm shining a light on them today, which feels good. I'm sure someone would have done it eventually, but, you know, the sooner the better. Hopefully, if any of the people mentioned are watching, they like what they see. Let me know in the comments. Also, let me know any of your memories from watching these shows. It would be fun to be reminded of some of the episodes that are lost in the back of my brain. And, you know, spoiler warning for this whole video, of course. This stuff is from the 90s. I also added a couple of well-known Canadian stars in the mix. So while some of these actors may be obscure now, others are Oscar-nominated, critically acclaimed, and... For those actors, I'll stop covering them when we hit their breakout role because we all know the rest. But we'll get to them later. To start, let's go back to the early 90s. No. No. We have to go way back. Love that sound. The Odyssey is a Canadian half-hour adventure fantasy TV show for kids created by Paul Bitois and originally broadcast on CBC from 1992 to 1995. I remember coming across the pilot of the show and somehow confusing it with The Twilight Zone for the longest time. It freaked me out and I was super curious to see more, but I don't remember watching it too much after that initial experience. What I do remember is I was stopping channel surfing when I saw anything sci-fi-ish on the screen, and though I wouldn't usually find this show, I'd be introduced to other shows that aired in the 90s like Weird Science and Animorphs, which we'll be covering on the next episode. The show stars Elia Wolleshin as Jay Ziegler, as well as Ashley Rogers and Tony Sampson as Donna Alpha and Keith Flash, respectively. I actually watched the pilot to do some research for this video and ended up getting sucked into the storyline. The show's good. Still holds up today even though it screams like 90s vibes. The Odyssey centers around a boy named Jay, played by Elia Wolleshin, who falls out of a tree fort and hits his head leading to a coma. He wakes up in a creepy elevator heading downwards and finds himself in a Lord of the Flies type world where there are no adults. The show switches between the world in Jay's head, the Lord of the Flies world, and our real world in 1992. In the real world, Jay's mom is usually taking care of him with the help of his friends Donna and Keith. He sometimes comes close to waking up out of his coma, but in the dream world, he's forced to turn back for multiple reasons. The first season saw Jay attempting to reach the tower, a large building in the distance. As he, Alpha, and Flash journey to the tower each episode, they come across different groups of kids, such as the group of kids in a cult, a group of kids that are obsessed with books, another who are obsessed with art, and some just want to play games all day, etc., etc. The dream world is also inhabited by a militarized group of older kids, sneakily pushing an anti-fascist agenda onto the viewers. The writing is great and leaves the viewer begging for more. I think another good comparison to this show is Lost, both for like switching between different storylines and the mystery element of it all. Anyways, a really famous guy played a supporting character at the end of season 1 as the villain, and it shocked me when I saw him. But first, let's talk about the two leads, Ilya Wolishin and Ashley Asin Moore, or Ashley Rogers. Ilya Wolishin, a first-generation Ukrainian-Canadian, was the lead in The Odyssey and previously played the lead role of Kristoff in 1992's Beethoven Lives Upstairs. So it was a film we all watched in like grade 3 music class, and a minor role in the 80s incarnation of The Twilight Zone in 1988.
Are you sick again, Danny?
Yeah.
On stage, he first appeared in the production of Jacob Tutu and The Hooded Fang as Jacob at the age of 7 in Toronto's Young People's Theatre before landing a role in the March 1989 to May 1990 Royal Alexandria Theatre run of Les Miserables, playing Gavroche. This production is remembered fondly by theatergoers. While filming The Odyssey, Ilya also starred in Are You Afraid of the Dark episode. I get into Are You Afraid of the Dark in episode 1 as well. Unfortunately, it looks like he found limited success in the industry after The Odyssey, only appearing in one production as a supporting character in a single episode of Mythic Warriors Guardians of Legend in 1998, during the 4-year period after The Odyssey was cancelled. He appeared in this last production when he was just 19 years old. In researching what Ilya Wolishin is up to now, I found a number of sources stating how he had trouble being a child star in the film industry. This aligns with a number of child stars from the OG Little Rascals, Judy Garland from Wizard of Oz, all the way to Lark Voorhees, Corey Haim, who's also an 80s Canadian child star born in Toronto, Shia LaBeouf, Orlando Brown, Lindsay Lohan, it's looking like even maybe Justin Bieber, with countless other examples in between. It seems like some assholes can't have power without abusing it in the most pathetic ways. I'm talking to you, Diddy. Anyways, Ilya passed away on January 19, 2023 in Barrie, Ontario, the city where he was born at just 44 years of age. He was survived by his wife Tanya, and I didn't see information about any children. There's no cause of death, just that it happened suddenly in his home. In finding his Facebook and his Twitter profiles, it's clear that he was a down-to-earth guy and someone I might have even enjoyed having a beer with. He was an avid NBA fan and hip-hop fan, though it seems like he may have had some issues at some point and attempted to unalive himself. It's just sad that a guy was so prominent in so many 90s kids' early lives and past and nobody really knew about it. I couldn't even find a news article about it. To date, there's only 2 messages of condolence on his obituary page. I'm going to write a message, and I encourage anyone else who is a fan of The Odyssey or Ilya to do the same. I'll leave a link in the description. I'm sure that his family would appreciate the warm messages. Rest in peace, Ilya. Your fans will always remember you. The second of the main characters in The Odyssey I wanted to highlight is Ashley Asin Moore. Now, I'm kind of cheating here because she was born in California, but she moved to BC at a young age and lived with her mother in Richmond for most of her childhood with a dual citizenship, so kind of counts. Her American father was hardly in her life. In an interview with the Vancouver Sun in 1995, the then 13-year-old Moore attributed her career to her first grade teacher encouraging her to try acting. She then went on to point out that she has had minimal training, which influences her to act in a certain way. This is apparent in the performance in The Odyssey, where she acts in like an almost more realistic way than the rest of the cast. It gives off the look like she's light years ahead of her co-stars, and maybe that's the secret sauce.
Oh.
I have it
with
here.
Okay, Jay. Now I want you to send me one thought. My mind is clear and relaxed. Come on, Jay. Send me a thought. I'm ready.
She ended up nominated for a 1993 Gemini Award for a role in Family Strangers and was the winner of the 6th annual 1994 YTV Youth Achievement Award, beating out 87 other nominees. But this is where the story takes a turn. In 1995, Moore was cast in Now and Then, a big-budget Hollywood picture. She acted alongside Christina Ricci, Thora Birch, and Gabby Hoffman, all of whom have had successful careers that are still going to this day. They played the younger versions of Melanie Griffith, Rosie O'Donnell, Demi Moore, and Rita Wilson's characters in the 1970s. So again, big role. And Ashley Moore specifically was playing the younger version of Rita Wilson.
New Line Cinema presents Christina Ricci and Rosie O'Donnell as Roberta. Thora Birch and Melanie Griffith as Teeny.
Look at how big mine are today.
They almost look real.
Gabby Hoffman and Demi Moore as Samantha.
You can hear me give a sigh.
Ashley Aston Gore and Rita Wilson as Chrissy. In a story of the children they were.
Afterward.
And the friends they became.
Even when strong.
Now and Then, directed by Leslie Linklater, rated PG-13, starts Friday.
The film flashed back and forth between the past and the then president in 1995, hence the title Now and Then. Anyways, it was a box office success and Moore was critically praised for the role as Chrissy, a character that was overweight.
You sure got gentlemen back there, I'm gentle. Oh, howdy, howdy, step and one sign, sign, step. You are my candy girl. And you got me watching you.
Oh,
Roberta, you missed your spot.
Push your butt off the asphalt and help.
You know if I don't eat every few hours, I get nauseous.
And you got me watching you. Warmer or
I thought it was something foul.
Maybe it's John gets Largot.
Oh, your wit astounds me.
Hey, I don't know. Come on, man, let's get out of here.
Ladies.
Yes,
it's his problem.
Maybe he's a pod person.
Maybe he's not such a creep after all.
Yeah, well,
but hey, man.
According to IMDb, Kirsten Dunst says she turned down the role because she refused to gain the weight for her character. The weight gain was not an issue for Moore, who was quoted as stating that the character needed it. She also finally broken out of TV and into film. The Vancouver Sun article mentions how, although she was grateful for the role, Moore's been having a tough time losing the 20 pounds she gained to play Chrissy in Now and Then. The article closes by stating that Moore plans to eventually quit acting and become a doctor researching naturopathic medicine. 20 pounds is insane for a 13-year-old to have to gain for any role. Sorry, the metal's hurting my feet. I need to put on some slippers. Throughout Now and Then, Moore's character Chrissy is constantly belittled for her weight, and this could have easily become something that she began to tell herself and internalize after the role was over, as she was having trouble losing that same weight. Regardless, I found multiple reports of people she knew basically explaining that she had Munchausen syndrome. For those that don't know, it's a psychological disorder in which those affected feign or induce disease, illness, injury, abuse, or psychological trauma to draw attention, sympathy, or reassurance to themselves. This could have been a result of the lack of roles she received over the last 10 years of her life. In doing some research, I found that she had fallen into drugs and by 2007 was addicted to heroin. She was also being talked about in negative ways online since at least 2004. Here's a MySpace post that she made in 2007. Back from where exactly? Ashley ended up dying in her sleep on December 10, 2007 in Richmond, BC, the city her career started. Unfortunately, acting didn't take her back to her birthplace in California. I found conflicting reports of an overdose, or that she got clean and her immune system was shot leading to pneumonia, or that she got pneumonia from the overdose. I'm not sure which one's real. Regardless, it's a loss that, from what I can tell, was a sacrifice for us to be able to watch her on TV and film. It's really sad stuff. In a 2015 ABC look back at Now and Then, Thora Birch stated that Ashley was a really cool kid. She had a great personality, and I remember making fun of Chrissy's lines with her from time to time because neither of us could believe that Chrissy was so clueless. I had not heard about her passing until a couple of years ago, and was saddened by the news. She still lives on as Chrissy to me, though. This gives me the vibe that they weren't really friends outside of the roles they played, and that's unfortunate because maybe the dynamic between the girls may have been poisoned by the three girls cast as skinny, having a negative effect on Ashley Moore's self-image.
Ashley, I don't know if you've done this before, this junket kind of thing, have you?
Yes.
Oh, so you're an old pro at this.
I've been doing this for 9 years, so I'm used to it.
And how old are you now?
I was 14 yesterday.
Well, a belated happy birthday to you.
Thank you very much.
Where do you call home?
Vancouver, Canada.
Oh, what a lovely city.
Isn't it just... See, another person that said it's wonderful.
Oh, I love
We're having
Vancouver.
A competition on what's better, L.A., New York, or Vancouver.
Oh, no question there.
No question.
For me.
Thank you. You heard that.
How do you think 12 and 13-year-old girls today are different from the girls you play in the movie?
A lot less naive. They've lost a lot of the innocence that Chrissy and that the girls have. I mean, They're a lot harder. They're a little bit more tough around the edges. But they have to be, because we're in a society where, in an environment which has changed so drastically within the last 15 years. And so I think it's been they're a lot more cynical too when you think about it. But I mean, I don't think it's a bad thing. I think it's wonderful to have innocence and to be yet naive, but there's only to a point you can take it, because if we still did have that, can you imagine having that with all of the problems we're facing today? It's just crazy.
Ashley was definitely having a rough go of it by her mid-20s. This was the mid-2000s, and it was the internet forum era. I found multiple forums where she's not only being attacked for not having a successful career, but her life and issues are also being exhibited for the world to see. All of this would have a negative effect on anyone who's just trying to get their shit together. Especially since this whole time she's processing having an absentee father. She had a magnifying glass on her because she's a child star, so everything she did wrong was amplified, but at the same time, that same stardom didn't amount to shit when it came to putting bread on the table. It's almost like a trap, and on May 17, 2007, 6 months before her death, she wrote, "Half the man I used to be, feel like a shadow of my former self. I'm tired, so very tired." It's unfortunate that she didn't get the help she so desperately needed. Our friend wrote a heartwarming blog post describing her sadness of losing someone who meant so much to her and some of the things they would do together. Ashley seemed fun. She joins the likes of River Phoenix and Brad Renfro, as well as Janis Joplin and Sid Vicious and Jim Morrison, all gone too soon from complications with heroin. Lastly, I found this site, it's still up by the way, that was essentially making fun of her weight and how she looked in the then year 2007. The post was made 3 days before she died, and it's a sad thought, but this could have had a role to play. In 2007, we weren't as knowledgeable as we are now about online bullying, and high-profile cases like Amanda Todd's were still 5 years away. Ashley was cremated, and her remains were scattered at a dog park she frequented with her dog Gizmo. One member had this to say. Ash died about a week and a half ago. She was always trying out a lot of drugs and getting into trouble. She hated when people would ask her autograph and stuff, and I think that being famous at a young age really took hold of her and drove her to experiment with drugs the way she did. Anyways, I was at a memorial last night, and the family's keeping this under wraps because they don't want the media attention, as that is what they think caused this overdose. Everyone knew Ash was into drugs, and everyone tried to stop her, but she wouldn't listen. As a friend and cousin of Ashley's, I'm sad and upset at her death, but it's really not a shock to me. She was a wild girl who grew up too fast, and she's in a better place now. Hopefully her website and others will not bother her family and respect their wishes. I love you, Ash, with all my heart. Rest in peace, Ashley. Your fans will never forget you. As for Tony Sampson, the third lead who played Flash and Keith, he seems to have a family and is doing well in Fort McMurray, Alberta. He voiced one of the Eds in Ed, Edd n Eddy.
How back for a quarter?
Among other animation gigs throughout the 2000s until his last credited role in 2013, although he did act in Hey Alice, a short in 2020 as well. So I guess there's a silver lining to the story of The Odyssey, but sadly it looks like he and Ilya were on the outs, as he was writing pretty disparaging things on Ilya's Facebook page while he was still alive and crying out for help. I've been mulling over the idea of doing a deep dive video solely on The Odyssey, as I found some great content and behind the scenes info, from the making of to the casting and production. More information on the passing of Ilya and Ashley, and some stuff on the guy we're getting to next, plus a bunch more from the creators. I guess you could call it Odyssey Retrospective. So if you guys are interested in an Odyssey deep dive like that, just let me know in the comments below.
Who's that Pokemon?
The last actor I want to talk about in the Odyssey is someone who's truly special, and as I said earlier, played the villain, Micro, introduced in the two-part finale of season one. Ryan motherfucking Reynolds. Yeah, Ryan Reynolds is in here at age 16, and wildly enough, he already has that Ryan Reynolds aura.
Are you eating seeds? Get out of my meeting.
Melissa, do a seed search on that guy next time. Thanks, darling.
You want to know what we should do with this kid? We should study him. I've seen what's in his head. Now, you may find these results stunning, even groundbreaking, but I believe this J-Kid is from someplace else. A different dimension, if you will. We must analyze his mind if we are to understand the mystery of our own existence. Where did we come from, Macro? Where are we going?
You lost me. Buff that one more.
He's already playing a villain character opposite the leads, and this is just his second acting credit. The first being on a show called Hillside, or 15 in some markets. born in Vancouver. After The Odyssey, Reynolds acted in a number of small productions and a couple of bigger ones too, before his big break in 2002. Some of the productions he was part of include The Outer Limits, The X-Files, Sabrina the Teenage Witch, the movie, not the show that came after the movie, Coming Soon, Dick, and Two Guys and a Girl. Finally, in 2002, 10 years after he began playing Micro in The Odyssey, Reynolds broke out as the titular Van Wilder, and the rest, as they say, is Hollywood history. He married Scarlett Johansson, and they divorced. Then he married Blake Lively, and they divorced. And now he's happily married to Hugh Jackman. Keep killing it, Rye. Or can I call you Rye?
Who's that Pokemon?
There's still a few big-name actors on the list, but for now I wanted to give a short highlight to the first of two groups of siblings we'll talk about today, Carrie and Shannon Duff. If you were watching Canadian Kids TV in the 90s, you couldn't avoid these two. And while Carrie acted in a number of different productions, her older sister, Shannon, had a set role in Crass Creatures and was a mainstay in that show. Crass Creatures was a wildlife show that was aimed at educating kids about the natural world. It centered around brothers Chris and Martin Kratt traveling worldwide, exploring different animals and their habitats. You may have seen these two in the spin-offs of Boomafoo that started airing in 1999, but Crass Creatures was the OG, first coming on in 1996. Shannon Duff played Allison, a girl in the chair, for the brothers who was usually found at the base, but occasionally was out in the field as well. She essentially played a computer whiz, and her knowledge would get the brothers out of sticky situations. And her character was used to expand and give context to topics discussed in the Kratt Brothers segments. I never got too deep into the nature stuff. I guess I leaned towards the sci-fi and cartoons more, but I had cousins who loved both Kratt's Creatures and Zaboomafoo, so I remember the shows pretty fondly. It's like a memory intertwined with the nostalgia of visiting my family as a kid. You know what I mean? I miss that shit. Anyways, prior to Crass Creatures, Duff was in both Are You Afraid of the Dark and Goosebumps. It was that Haunted Mask episode. She also played Tiffany in The Magic School Bus for three episodes from 1995 to 1997 before taking a break from acting. 6 years later, Duff was in a 2003 TV movie, Good Fences, starring Whoopi Goldberg and Danny Glover, and an episode of 1800 Missing, a Vivica Fox-led FBI show. Another TV movie called Crimes of Fashion, starring Megan Fox and Kaley Cuoco in 2004, and finally had a voice role in two episodes of Growing Up Creepy in 2006. Since then, Shannon has effectively disappeared from the internet and can't be found. And trust me, I'm not the only one looking. I found multiple posts on old forums of people trying to figure out what she's been up to after all these years throughout the 2010s. She was a big deal in the House of the Watch Crass Creatures as she was the only kid in the show, but yeah, nobody has a clue what happened to her. The general consensus is that she changed her name or married and changed her name as she was engaged at some point and is happily living a quiet life in Toronto. I guess she doesn't want to be found, so maybe it's better that we just leave her alone. If that's the case, hope you're happy and healthy, Shannon, and thanks for the memories. Carrie Duff, Shannon's younger sister, had a different career trajectory, but she may have ended up in the same place. Born in Whitby, Ontario, Shannon's birthplace is unknown. Carrie is 2 years younger than her older sister. Carrie began her career on an episode of Ghost Rider, a show which included Samuel Jackson, Julia Stiles, and others. She was, of course, like all Canadian child stars, in an episode of Goosebumps and Are You Afraid of the Dark, playing Shadia Simmons' older sister on both. I highlighted Shadia Simmons in episode 1. As well as guest starring in The Magic School Bus, all productions her older sister Shannon was part of as well, albeit on different episodes. But this is where their paths diverge, because while Shannon Duff had a long-standing role in Kratt's Creatures, a kids' nature show, after a couple of TV movies, Blind Faith and Mr. Headmistress, Carrie earned a starring role as the titular character's love interest in the famous Jet Jackson.
The ultimate action hero. Top agent for a secret organization. Saving the world, one mission at a time. At least that's what I play on TV. In real life, I'm Jet Jackson. Being a TV star is cool, but being a regular kid is even better. So I had the show move back to my hometown, Willsted, North Carolina. Now, I can hang with my friends, which is great. And the best part of all, I get to spend a lot more time with my family. Hey, I'm just trying to live my life as a normal kid, but some people still see me as the famous Jet Jackson.
The Famous Jet Jackson was a show I loved. I mean, I'm black and he's black, and to be honest, on cable back then, that was enough. But the show also had heart.
Forgive me.
A show within a show, somewhat like The Odyssey or more recently Lost and Yellow Jackets, with flashes between two different storylines but with a completely different premise. Basically, Jet Jackson, played by Lee Thompson Young, was a teenage kid living in LA with his mom while acting on a TV show called Silverstone, in which he plays a secret agent. Because he misses his friends, he convinces the producers to move the show to where his dad still lives with his grandmother, Willsted, North Carolina, the fictional quiet rural American town that he grew up in. The guy must have had some serious juice to convince the producers to do that, like a young Timothy Chalamet or something. Hey, now stop! Hey, now stop!
Dance, Timmy Tim, pull up your pants. Hooli hooku shit, I think my wings just be from France. It's Lil Timmy Tim, I am a boss. You really like my shirt, should I take it off? See me with a girl and you know it's getting cuddly. See me in the hallway and you know I hear my Dougie. Feel good music, I'm bringing it back. What's wrong with that kid? Does he think that he's black? Chop! It's Timmy Tim, it's Timmy Tim, chop! It's Timmy Tim, the Timmy Tim, not chop! Hey, not chop! Hey, now chop! Hey, now chop! Hey, now chop! Now chop! Hey, now chop! Hey, now chop! Hey, now chop! Hey guys, I see y'all on the dance floor, don't know how to act. Trying to steal my swag, but your swag don't match. Since day zero, Lil Timmy Timo win. Hit my Tim Tebow, hit my Jeremy Lin.
Anyways, in his hometown, when he's not filming, he's hanging out with his best friends, JB and Kayla, and sometimes the special effects guy in the show, Cubby. Then randomly, the show will flash to a B storyline, an episode of Silverstone, the show Jet Jackson's shooting, and that show will have its own plot and has nothing to do with the real storyline. It's not one of those, the themes connect in both plot shows. It's just one of the shows that has two shows in one, and that was awesome. Thompson Young had this Will Smith aura that you had to see to truly understand.
And you're the only one I trust. Now this is your name tag.
Harold. How about a strong name like Nasir?
My father's name was Harold.
The show tackled a lot of issues involving race, mental issues, and gentrification, among other topics, and Jet would be sure to learn a lesson from his grandmother, Miss Coretta, or his dad, who I forgot to mention is not only a cop, but the sheriff. Also, Britney Spears randomly showed up at one of their Halloween parties. The show ran from 1998 to 2001 and ended with a TV movie in 2001 where Jet and Silverstone switch places, and Silverstone finds himself in Willsted, North Carolina, while Jet is mistaken for a secret agent. You know, that whole thing. Sadly, Lee Thompson Young passed away in August 2013. Struggling with bipolar disorder, he was working steadily up to his death, acting as Barry Frost in Rizzoli and Isles from 2010, and the role wasn't going anywhere, but he was suffering in silence and was unable to get the help he needed. Tragically, he unalived himself by gunshot alone in his home. He was just 29. Rest in peace, Lee. You don't know how much of a role model you really were for us. As for Ryan Summers-Baum, who played JB, this was actually his first role, and after Jet Jackson, he had a small role in a TV movie and called the whole acting thing quits. Now he's an ordained minister. Back to Carrie Duff. She had a starring role in Jet Jackson, second to Lee Thompson Young. After Jet Jackson ended in 2001, Duff seems to have taken a break from acting until 2006 when she appeared in an episode of Instant Star, and after that, it looks like she took another hiatus until she voiced the titular Penny in 2012's Zack and Penny, an animated film. The info on Carrie Duff after this is scarce. I found that around 2008, during one of her breaks, she was working at a Rogers Video in Whitby. In a 2012 interview with the Sioux City Journal, Ryan Summers-Baum stated that he was in touch with her and she's traveling to different countries and teaching children how to speak English. Sounds like a good excuse to quit acting. Keep up the positive work, Carrie. Now, I know I promised another huge Hollywood star, and they're coming soon.
But first,
who remembers Radio Free Roscoe?
All you ever hear, look like this, think like this, be like this. How do you fight it? We started our own radio station. We keep our identities secret. It gives us the power to say what we want as loud as we want.
We change the rules around. We've got a different sound. Tuned into the underground.
Listening to Radio Free Roscoe.
Radio Free Roscoe was a 2003 to 2005 teen comedy drama in which four friends in grade 9 start their own radio station after attempting and failing to take part in extracurricular activities. It's essentially about the first podcast. Well, not the first, but a podcast before a podcast. Al Mukadam played Ray Pronto Brennan, who didn't make the school play. Nathan Stevenson played Robbie Question Mark McGrath and was the unofficial lead. He made the school radio program, but he was disappointed when he got there. Kate Todd played Lily Shady Lane Randall, who choked when she tried to sing in the talent show. And Nathan Carter played Travis Smog Strong, who lost out on the radio position to Robbie. Robbie decides to quit the highly censored school radio program in order to say what he wants on the air using Travis's radio on a pirated station. Pirated stations are stations that operate without a license. See, I told you, podcast. Anyways, the pilot episode ends with all the friends signing off on their first show. Throughout the run of the show, the characters confront teen challenges, go through relationships, issues with families, friends, school, etc., while juggling the responsibilities of the radio station, Radio Free Roscoe, which is named after the fictional town they live in, Roscoe, New Jersey. Some of the guest stars in the show included Lauren Collins, Sky Sweetnam, Jake Epstein, and Drake. Meanwhile, the show was internationally syndicated in countries like Australia, Poland, USA, Russia, Italy, Brazil, Israel, Finland. I'll be honest, I only watched this when I was flipping channels and nothing else happened to be on. Looking back though, I kind of feel like I missed out because the whole show was about getting through censorship and free speech, and that's all stuff I'm kind of into today. You know, say what you want, but just don't cry about the consequence. Anyways, I wanted to highlight two actors from the show, Nathan Stevenson and Kate Todd. Starting with Nate Stevenson.
Come on. Okay. We are buying money from the money from Nathan Stevenson. How can you show that we... Wait, when did he say you're in a Radio Free Roscoe? Yeah. This is the one of stars. This money is his. Hi. We booked it up here.
People may remember him as looking like the dude from the High School Musical. I actually haven't seen High School Musical, but that guy was everywhere. Anyways, we're not talking about that random guy. Although I can do a video on American Child Stars too if y'all want. Let me know in the comments. Okay, back to Nate. Born in Toronto, he started his career and the main role was Jason in System Crash.
By the way, today's show is about creativity and expression, which we're not even free to verbalize in this police state.
Well, enjoy the show. Take care.
Another show that I would see on, but I never really watched. Sorry, you can't watch them all. Before landing the role he's known for as the lead in Radio Free Roscoe. After Roscoe, Nate was cast in Child Star before the straight-to-DVD Cyber Seduction, Heartstopper, and a role in Dark Oracle. After this, Nate gets starred in Natural Sadie, which is another show I didn't watch, but I always saw commercials for. Next, Stevenson played Tamara Maori's ex in Twitches 2. And a side note, apparently the sister aren't talking anymore. You can't have the sister without the sister. I mean, that's a fucking travesty. In 2007, Nate then guest starred in both The Dresden Files and Degrassi, playing Griffin, an HIV positive student that the main characters room with in university. He then voiced Errol in Gotta Catch Santa, Jasper in Pearly, and played Daryl in Skyrunners, both TV movies. Getting into the 2010s, Nate played Gord in My Babysitter's a Vampire and guest starred in the episodes of Aaron Stone, Nikita, Warehouse 13, and Alphas. In 2012 and 2014, he voiced Ken and Klaus in Bay Wheels and Bay Warriors, colon Bay Raiders, along with Ryan Cooley from episode 1. I gather these are Beyblade spinoffs? That shit came out when I was in middle school and they're still milking it? Tops? After those two roles, Nate quietly moved on from acting. Today, Nate's a new dad who's currently working at an auto financier as a field sales specialist. He looks like he's really enjoying life and being a dad. Congrats on the little one, Nate. Kate, I just realized their names rhyme, had a different career path. Kate Todd was a lead in Roscoe and was born in Barrie and interestingly began her career as a guest in one of the shows I highlighted in episode 1, Strange Days of Blake Holsey High, Black Hole High internationally. Next, she had a role in the TV movies More Sex and the Single Mom and Bookie Makes Her Mark. She then landed roles in the Tracy Fragments and Grizzly Rage before she guest starred in Natural Sadie as well. After this, she was a recurring character for 10 episodes of Life with Derek and 2 episodes of Degrassi before landing a supporting role in Saving God, a TV movie. Next, she played Heidi Montag in an episode of Family Guy, had a recurring role in the first season of Cashing In, and reunited with Nathan Stevenson in the TV movie My Babysitter's a Vampire. The two seem to be on the same wavelength and appear in a bunch of the same productions. After an episode of Rookie Blue, Todd found a lead role in My Babysitter's a Vampire, the TV show, based on the film she'd just been part of and playing the same character. Next, she played a character with her own name, Kate, in The L.A. Complex, which also starred Cassie Steele at Degrassi and centered around a group of 20-somethings living in an L.A. apartment complex and going through a relationship, blah, blah, blah. It was canceled after 2 seasons, but has positive reviews. It also starred Jewel State, whose spoiler alert will be highlighted in episode 3. But back to Kate Todd. After a role in As Is For Bird, a short, and The Good Witch's Destiny, a TV movie, and a guest role in both Satisfaction and Lost Girl, Kate Todd shifted her career to music, where she's found success as a singer-songwriter. In 2012, she released her debut album, Finding My Way, which won Best New Album in the 2012 Radio Nation Music Awards. Since then, she's released a Christmas country album, aptly titled Country Christmas, in 2014, and a sophomore album, Anywhere With You, in 2015. Currently, as I said before, Kate Todd is on the same wavelength as Nathan Stevenson, as she too just welcomed her baby girl, and is clearly living her best life as well. Stay tuned until the end of the video, because I'm going to wrap this video up with Kate performing an original song, but for now, keep killing it, Kate. Cheers. So in the last video, I told you guys that I went to school with Michael Cera, but I didn't tell you about the first time I met him.
But it's not for sure. I won't ever change. And though my love is great, and though my love is true,
let the dogs out.
So it was the summer before I started middle school, and he was in grade 8, and I was gonna go into grade 7. He was going to grade 8. So there's a public swimming pool by the house I used to live at in Brampton called Loafer's Lake. Actually, it was renamed, but we still call it Loafer's Lake because that's where all the preteen dances were on Friday nights in grade 6 and 7, and that's, you know, that's where we grew up. Fuck, we were fake clubbing to Nelly and Hot in here before we did the real thing. I just realized that. Do kids even fake club anymore? Anyways, Michael Cera. Stay focused, ADHD. So me and my buddies are leaving the pool one day, and Michael Cera turns to the corner, and, you know, being the dumbass kid I was, I yell out, "Hey, you're the guy from that show." This, that was sixth grade alien at the time. I'd seen him in it, right? I'd talk about that show in episode 1 as well. What are you doing in Brampton? And I'll never forget his answer. "I live here, dumbass. LOL." Well, he didn't say LOL. He just laughed in my face. I wrote LOL on the script. Then everyone started laughing. His friends, my friends, everyone. It seems mean, but to be fair, I am a dumbass. I literally just said it 20 seconds ago, so kudos to you, Mike. You got me. Anyways, after that, I was mad. I didn't want to talk to him for the rest of the year. And after that, I went to, funnily enough, the drama high school. And he went to, funnily enough, the normal high school for a year or so before he moved to LA and, you know, starred in Arrested Development. So, yeah, fun times in my childhood, I guess. Now, by popular request, let's talk about Michael Cera. So he started out in a Pillsbury commercial and took improvisation classes and torched me from those classes, LOL, before landing his first real role in Sixth Grade Alien. He then played a bully in Naughty.
"You must be one of the kids they want me to play with after I do my homework. But I don't want to do my homework. Hey, I bet I can make him do my homework. Hey, you, kid."
"Well, hi, I'm DJ. What's your name?"
"They call me Butch. You got a problem with that?"
A show my parents put on for my sister every morning. I can still hear the intro. Here at the 90s.
"Welcome to our place. We've been waiting. Time for some fun and celebrating.
Something is always ready to pop.
Here at the 90s shop.
Music and magic. Hey, it's showtime.
Naughty and you will be friends in no time.
Family.
Actually, there were a few Canadian stars in Nada you may recognize, including Katie Boland, Lauren Collins, Jake Goldsby, Shadia Simmons, and Michael Cedar, some of whom were mentioned in episode 1. After Nadi, Sarah found a role in one of those 500 Mary-Kate and Ashley movies, Switching Goals, and a TV movie, What Katie Did. It was around 2000 when Sarah landed his first Hollywood role as Gordy Jr. in Frequency and America Hoffman in Steal This Movie. He continued to work on television on the side, appearing in La Femme Nikita and doing voiceovers in Anne of Green Gables and George Shrinks, as well as Ripping Fans, before guest starring in Doc and 4 TV movies, Stolen Miracle, My Louisiana Sky, The Familiar Stranger, and Walter and Henry. Ending 2001, Sarah secured a longtime role on Braceface while earning another Hollywood role in 2002 on Confessions of a Dangerous Mind as a young Sam Rockwell. He then would take a 5-year break from film, but for good reason, because after a voice role in Roly Poly Oly and Bacola, he found the role that was written for him in Arrested Development, George Michael Bluth, a character whom he played on and off for the next 16 years. Finally, after his first stint on Arrested Development, he was cast in the role we all know made him a star, as Evan in Superbad.
Hi, did you hear about the party tonight?
Yeah, I just heard. It sounds awesome.
Yeah, I'm going.
Really?
Yeah, I'm gonna go to it. That's actually why I came looking for you. Me and the guys are gonna go to a liquor store after class, and I just thought, you know, if you needed someone to get you yours, I could do that. I could be that person.
Yeah, that would be great. That would save me such a hassle, because I was gonna beg my sister, but...
Oh.
Could you get me, like, a bottle of Gold Slick vodka?
Yeah, that's the one with the little golden flakes in it?
Yeah, the girly one.
It's classy.
Okay, well, I'll pay you back at the party, then.
No, you won't. No, it's my treat, miss.
Really?
Yep, and that's that. It's the first of many, too, so get used to it, sister.
Oh, well, thank you.
Yeah, no problem. I'm sorry. That guy walked by. It was an accident.
It's okay.
I was gonna give you, like, a nudge on the ear, like a punch, a friend thing.
It's okay.
I didn't mean, I'm sorry.
Hey,
that...
Becca.
Oh, hey.
Hey.
Abby.
What's up, Evan?
Hey, Gabby.
We should get to class.
We're gonna go to class, so I will see you tonight.
Okay.
Really, don't worry.
Okay, sorry.
Okay, bye.
Sorry. Bye. Sorry.
Michael Cera is still working in both film and television and was just recently in an episode of Black Mirror and the Barbie movie with another Canadian child star that we'll get to later. Currently he's filming the new Wes Anderson movie, which we all know will be a box office success.
What did I say? What did I say? Everything has to be symmetrical!
Keep it up, bro, and, you know, I forgive you, lol. Okay, so we took a little detour into the 2000s, but now we're going way back to talk about two guys that I didn't even realize were related, never mind brothers. Both were always on my TV in the 90s, just not at the same time. I'm talking about Kyle and Jason Alisharan. I'll start with Jason because he's the eldest boy.
It doesn't even make any sense! I'm the eldest boy!
Coming from a Trinity background, Jason was born in Richmond, BC. He only held one long-standing role, but it was extremely memorable, as Frank the Tough Kid in the Midnight Society of Are You Afraid of the Dark.
Let's have a little recap here to get you back up to speed.
Okay. Rush and Max were brothers who didn't really get along. All Rush wanted to do was grow up, but Max was always keeping him down.
I instantly recognized him when I looked up his brother and was shocked that they were related. I also found some more Are You Afraid of the Dark tea that the show was featured in episode 1. According to Jason in a 2010 interview, he and his brother auditioned for roles, and because they were casting the Midnight Society and the actors and the stories for each episode at the same time, he ended up getting cast as a series lead for the entire run while his brother was cast in just one episode, which we'll get to in a moment. Another tidbit is the fact that they filmed all of the Midnight Society sections at the same time in one huge block. It was about 2 months of filming, but it lasted a full year of shows. As of 2010, Jason has stayed in touch with Are You Afraid of the Dark co-stars Rachel Blanchard, who played Cher Horowitz in the Clueless TV show and is still acting today on The Summer I Turned Pretty, and Joanna Garcia, who was in Freaks and Geeks Once Upon a Time and most recently was a lead in Netflix's Sweet Magnolias. Back to Jason. After starring in Are You Afraid of the Dark for 5 years, he found a role in the TV movie The Halfback of Notre Dame and an episode of Breaker High, which we'll get to in like 5 minutes. Before leaving the industry. Next, he restarted his career from scratch, starting in the mailroom of Endeavor Talent Agency and moving slowly up as an assistant for feature development on Collateral, Transformers, Meet the Fockers, Red Eye, and Paycheck, before developing the script for and co-producing 2009's Academy Award-nominated A Single Man, starring Colin Firth and Julianne Moore. Today, Jason is working in LA as a writer and producer for his own production company, JA Films. He still shows up for our You're Afraid of the Dark panels at conventions as well as does interviews about the show. Wish you all luck with your business, bro. Kyle Alishurin, 2 years younger than his brother Jason, was also born in Richmond, BC. After The Odyssey, as we mentioned before, Kyle was guest starred in the show that his brother was a main cast member of, Are You Afraid of the Dark, as well as Sliders playing a character with his actual name, Kyle. I love when actors play characters with their real names. It's cool. After this, he had a role in Short before landing his biggest role as Alex Pineda on Breaker High alongside Ryan Gosling. In an interview with Kyle, he states that at the time of filming, on and off the set, he hung out with Ryan Gosling and Tyler Labine the most. Breaker High lasted for just one season but racked up 44 episodes. Kyle took a 2-year hiatus from acting after Breaker High before landing the role as Deputy Frank Harris in 5 episodes of Higher Ground, Benito in an episode of Together, the series, and 2 episodes of the Jessica Alba show, which I, from what I remember, was from her breakout, Dark Angel. Kyle followed this up with guest starring on an episode of Mysterious Ways before acting in his last credited role as an airport worker in the 2006 box office dud, Snakes on a Plane. After acting, Kyle moved to the States to pursue education, getting a bachelor's in communication and a master's in sociology at Stanford University. A fellow master's grad, my guy. Today, Kyle resides in San Francisco and serves a new role as the chief financial officer at Replit, a software development company. This guy's range. He was a doofus in the Breaker High and became a CFO. That's badass. Kyle, keep showing them who's the boss. Now, as I mentioned before, Kyle's big break came in the form of a role in Breaker High. Breaker High was set in a high school cruise ship. Apparently there's a real program like this called Semester at Sea, and saw students experiencing high school show drama, dating, etc., while also visiting different parts of the world episode by episode. All the episodes were really all shot in BC, airing from 97 to 98. The show stood out from its contemporaries mainly because instead of focusing on tough topics like pregnancy, sexuality, etc., it leaned into more comedy. Having Ryan Gosling, Kyle Alishurin, and the third dummy in the trio, Tyler Labine, getting into all types of hijinks, while Terry Kahn, Persia White, who you may know from Girlfriends on BET, and Rachel Wilson would find themselves in unexpectedly comedic situations, like in the pilot, when the girls expected a spa trip in Japan, but were instead greeted with having to work in order to learn how to truly appreciate a spa.
My arms are fully spent from lugging water all day. According to Zen, total attention to one's task breeds tranquility. Besides, you guys were hearing me complaining I had to feed a yak. And it bit me.
Ladies, please. What are y'all complaining about? I'm getting a blemish.
I just hope these monks like to chow. I'm starving.
Kind sir, would you happen to have any fat-free balsamic vinaigrette?
Ugh, this food is seriously heinous.
Well, if I can't go to the facial will have to come to me. Desperate times call for desperate measures.
excuse me, sir. Could you please pass me a utensil? Excuse me, sir. What was that about?
That is a Sansho Roshi. He hasn't spoken a word in 20 years.
Oh, vow of silence?
Nothing nice to say.
20 years? I can't even go for 20 seconds.
That is the siren's bell. No more talking for the next 24 hours. Time to get on first name basis with mind.
But I'm not...
Meanwhile, the boys expect us to go on a boring fishing trip, but the fisherman gets sick and they end up having a party at his place.
Sweet! Hey, you be Luke, I'll be Darth Vader.
Hey guys, what about me?
You be Princess Leia.
Yeah.
Yeah, come on, I'm always Princess Leia.
No, Father!
Luke, come over to the dark side.
Never!
Whoa, watch out!
This is how you repay me for my hospitality.
We pay you, but we don't have any yen, you know?
You have dishonored my house and my name. Now we must fight to the end. Any last words?
Are those Bugle Boy jeans you're wearing? Huh? You're not really gonna kill us, dead daddy son, are you? I gotta know.
I got you! Pretty scary, huh?
Why didn't Barbie tell me about patriarchy? Which, to my understanding, is where men and horses run everything?
One of the shows that is truly randomly stupid in jokes. Both the boys' group and the girls' group find themselves on different sides of situations like this throughout the show. Brinker High wasn't particularly great and doesn't hold up like The Odyssey or You're Afraid of the Dark today, but it was a big fucking deal in the 90s. Surprisingly, Gosling was the goofball on this show, and from my memory, the guy that had the pictures in all the girls' lockers was Scott Vicarious, the tough, brooding, sensitive, misunderstood character. Apparently that changes quick. So finally, the one and only Ken, aka Noah Calhoun, aka Sebastian Wilder, aka Young Hercules, aka Ryan fucking Gosling. Young Hercules was a show set in the Hercules and Xena universe, and that was all the rage throughout the 1990s. It was actually wild.
Global's got a Saturday spectacular. Starting off with 90 minutes of adventure. Young Hercules, the movie. Find out how the legend began. Then Hercules rolls into more excitement and thrills. Followed by back-to-back action. Next, Xena kicks into high gear. It's a Saturday spectacular. Catch the non-stop action. Global's got it Saturday afternoon starting at 12:30.
The Sam Raimi-produced Hercules show led to Xena, then Young Hercules, then Sinbad, then Conan, then Robin Hood, then Beastmaster, then Tarzan, then Jack of All Trades, and finally Cleopatra 2025. Remember Cleopatra 2025? It was like an ancient magical show renaissance, and my theory is that this occurred because CGI was finally affordable to be used in TV shows, and not only in big budget film productions like Jurassic Park and Back to the Future, Star Wars, and Indiana Jones. Albeit, the CGI sucked. People were still excited to apply it to storytelling, especially the old stories like Hercules and Robin Hood, etc., that we've been telling each other for centuries. The concept for the Young Hercules show was Hercules was bringing in good money for the production company, and why not have a show targeting a younger audience too? Also, 1987's Disney's Hercules had released the year prior, and Hercules was kind of a big deal among kids and adults alike. Ian Bowen had already been playing the role of Young Hercules in the original Hercules series flashbacks, but after a TV movie, he turned down the main role of Young Hercules, leaving the character available for Ryan Gosling to land. Shot in New Zealand, Young Hercules definitely capitalized on the Disney film. Kids like me who owned the Disney film just wanted to see anything Hercules, and while the original show was there, it was too boring for an 8-year-old. Young Hercules was the perfect middle ground. And then I'd watch Disney's Hercules TV show, and then I'd have some cookies and milk, and then I'd, you know, play games and Lego and fucking N64 and Sega. All right, back to Ryan Gosling.
In an age of light and darkness, Zeus, king of the gods, ruled the universe. He had a son, Young Hercules. Man, Young Hercules longs to find his place in the world, the father he's never known, and what it means to be a hero. Before the man became legend, before the legend became myth, came the greatest adventure of all.
Interestingly, there was a kid in my class in grade 4, I think his name was Ben. And he moved away after that year, but he always bragged about his cousin being Young Hercules, who's Ryan Gosling. Back then he was Young Hercules to all us 9-year-olds. I wonder if he was really related to Gosling or if it was just bullshit. I guess I'll never know. Gosling was born in London, Ontario, but moved a lot as a kid, living in both Burlington and Cornwall as well. After his parents divorced, he was encouraged by his sister, who was also a performer, to sing with her. Gosling and his sister would then sing alongside his uncle's Elvis Presley act at weddings. It was around this time he developed his idiocentric accent, modeled after Marlon Brando, because he didn't think that his Canadian accent sounded tough enough.
Hi, this is my dog, Smidgen, and this is Lambert Park. This is where I like to come to walk my dog in the morning, so let's go.
At 17, he dropped out of high school to act full-time. A big gamble. Don't do that, kids. Finish your last year of high school at least, and then, you know, go party and turn up. Luckily for Ryan, he attended a Montreal audition for the Mickey Mouse Club in 1993 and got the role of a Mouseketeer in Orlando, Florida.
What a feeling.
Which of these eager young hopefuls will become part of the new Disney tradition? Find out on the exciting Mickey Mouse Club.
But when you think about it, don't it never rain? And I can say what, and I hold you at the
coming to the Disney Channel.
Basically an official Disney Channel star when it was just starting up.
That's TJ Fantini, and that's Tate, forget Tate's last name, Nikki DeLoach. That's Justin Timberlake, he's a young upstart in the business. I think he's got a real future. Christina Aguilera, Britney Spears.
Wow.
And that's Ryan Reynolds. That's very impressive. How is it you got in that group? Tell me about that. When did that happen? How did it happen?
I have no idea how that happens. I mean, they regretted it pretty quickly after they hired me.
How do you even get in that?
I auditioned.
Mm-hmm.
I was wanting to be a dancer, so all the girls in my class were auditioning.
Mm-hmm.
So I did too, and somehow I got on.
Wow.
And then when they hired me, they realized that I couldn't really dance or sing. I wasn't talented, so they stopped using me on the show.
But did you, this was a television show, it's the Disney, it's the Mickey Mouse Club Theater, right?
Yes, sir.
And you, where did they do it, in Florida?
They shot it in Orlando, Florida.
Now, did you, you're not from Florida, are you?
No, I'm from Canada.
Oh, you're from Canada. Whereabouts, where are you from, where? What town?
Paul Schaefer.
Yes.
Sir, you're a legend, sir.
Aren't you sweet? Where are you from in Canada?
I'm from Cornwall, Ontario.
Cornwall, of course, Southern Ontario. Yeah. Nice to see you.
You know, Canadians have a bit of an OCD.
Oh, is that right?
If a famous Canadian is mentioned, they have to name all the famous Canadians they can think of. And Paul's always the first one after whoever.
Hey, buddy.
Whoever is mentioned.
And then? Lauren Green, right after me. Lauren Green. Sex.
And James Naismith.
Invented
basketball.
Oh.
Canadian.
Oh, I had no idea that he was Canadian. How about that?
Yeah.
So now you move, how from Canada, Ontario, do you get down to Orlando?
Well, I went with my mom and we moved into a trailer park called Yogi Bear Park.
Well, why is it called Yogi Bear Park?
Because it was outside of Disney and it needed a theme.
I see. Everything in Central Florida has a theme then, I guess, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Have you ever lived in a...
I lived in a trailer park. How was that?
At Disney? Well... There's a class system in a trailer park.
He was working alongside Britney Spears, Christina Aguilera, and Justin Timberlake, with whom he was actually roommates at the time. Timberlake's mother was Gosling's legal guardian in the States, as his mother had to return to Canada on and off at times. And after the cancellation of the Mickey Mouse Club in 95, Ryan came back to Canada, where his career began to follow the same trajectory as a bunch of other actors are covered in both episode 1 and this episode. To start, he was in that very creepy radio episode of You're Afraid of the Dark, and then that creepier camera episode of Goosebumps. It's one of the only actual scary episodes of Goosebumps. Then he guest starred in an episode of Road to Avonlea, then Kung Fu the Legend continues. After Kung Fu, Gosling guest starred in an episode of Ready or Not, which is another show we're going to be covering in episode 3, and played Kenny in 1996's Frankenstein and Me. Later, he found a role guest starring in Psi Factor, Chronicles of the Paranormal. There were so many kids' Ghost Hunter shows back then, it was so fucking annoying. Like, I just wanted to watch a scripted show, like, fuck. And another guest role in Flash Forward, which is another show we're going to be highlighting in episode 3 coming soon, as well as in The Adventures of Shirley Holmes. And after 50 episodes of Young Hercules, Gosling played Josh in The Unbelievables, a failed TV pilot. Finally, in 2000, he got his first Hollywood break as one of the players on the T.C. Williams Titans. And remember the Titans as Alan Bosley, a small but memorable role.
Huh?
Yes. This one. I mean, I don't even have to ask, but I will. What do you think of this one?
Does the term cruel and unusual punishment mean anything to you?
At this point, whenever we'd see Gosling on TV, there'd be a conversation of, remember Baker High? Remember Young Hercules? That was him. We were like 3-4 years removed from those shows, but because there was no widespread internet and we couldn't find anything about those shows anymore, they were just off air. It was a memory, right? It was like a remember stodge. After Titans, Gosling continued to find work in Hollywood, starring as Danny Ballard in The Believer, Roy Hutney in The Slaughter Rule, Richard Haywood in Murder by Numbers, and Leland Fitzgerald in The United States of Leland throughout the early 2000s until 2004. In 2004, Gosling landed his breakout role in The Notebook, acting opposite Rachel McAdams, another Canadian born in London. Though not a former child star, she was too busy figure skating in her youth.
I wasn't very professional, but yes, I was a skater. I skated from 4 to 17 until I went to theater school.
That's a skater! Oh. 4 to 17? I'm like, I did it like once a year with all my friends and we fell down.
Anyways, The Notebook kicked off this highly successful career, and today Ryan's happily married to actress Eva Mendes and they have 2 daughters.
You're a bird, I'm a bird.
Gosling's received 3 Academy Award nominations for Half Nelson, La La Land, and Barbie, and won a Golden Globe for La La Land. He's currently producing and filming a space film in which he'll star, releasing in 2026. Keep it up, Ryan. You're literally on fire in the acting world right now. You'll get an Oscar soon enough. And now, ladies and gentlemen, Kate Todd.
This is Learning to Dance in the Rain.
Take my hand as we learn to dance in the rain.
So that's 6 more shows. The Odyssey, Kratz Creatures, The Famous Jet Jackson, Radio Free Roscoe, Breaker High, and Young Hercules. And 11 actors. Ilya Wollashin, Ashley Aston Moore, or Ashley Rogers, Ryan Reynolds, Shannon Duff, Carrie Duff, Nathan Stevenson, Kate Todd, Michael Cera, Jason Elisherin, Kyle Elisherin, and Ryan Gosling from the 1990s and 2000s. An honorable mention to The Worst Witch, which was airing on CBC but wasn't Canadian. Let's just say it was Harry Potter before Harry Potter. We'll leave it at that. Thanks for watching again, and if you're still watching at this point in the video, you've, like, blown my mind. I assumed that I would get maybe 4 or 5 views on all my videos, and I was really just doing this to prove to myself that I could do it. So all the love and support I receive makes it totally worth it and motivates me and inspires me to do more, and so thank you from the bottom of my heart. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I already have a bunch of shows lined up for episode 3, and I'm just deciding whether I'm going to do a big video for episode 3 or split it into 2 and have episode 3 and 4. As well as I have some other ideas for 90s topics going into the new year. So please consider subscribing if you want more nostalgia videos like this, as well as throw me a hype, a like, comment to help out with the algorithm. And let me know your favorite childhood show or film in the comments below. It doesn't have to be from the 90s. Just, you know, tell me what it is below. And tell me what you think below. Feedback is always appreciated, and I'm trying to improve in every video. If you haven't checked out episode 1, check it out. Link's in the description. So see you soon. Take care. And remember nostalgia. There's much more to come. Peace. Oh, and here's a sneak peek for episode 3 and the 90s pet movie video coming in early 2025. Thanks again, and I'll see you on the next one.
We all go play that Quidditch game in the sky. You know I got my eye on the prize. We all go play that Quidditch game in the sky. It's the little things that make life.
Make life.
And it's the small mistakes that take life.
Take life.
I'm just trying to make a way getting by.
Getting by.
Till I'm playing Quidditch way up in the sky. It's the little things that make life.
Make life.
And it's the small mistakes that take life.
Take life.
I'm just trying to make a way getting by.
Getting by.
Till I'm playing Quidditch way up in the sky.
Up late, one more episode before I crash. Gotta wake up early just to prep for class. We all gon' play that Quidditch game up in the sky. Sometimes a nigga sit and think why people die. Then I get deep and think why people live. Existential dread creeping from within. Tall like CN Tower, stay above the rim. Princes in the tower, King Edward V. Lost some day ones, I didn't think that I'd outlive. Think of y'all often pour a little bit. They'll be looking down on me with a foolish grin. While I'm swimming in the money, needing plans for fins. MCU had me feeling like a kid again. But ever since Chadwick died, it's been mid again. Got my eye on land like Gilligan. Trying to own my own property to shit up in.
It's the little things that make life.
Make life.
And the small mistakes that take life.
Take life.
I'm just trying to make a way getting by.
Getting by.
Till I'm playing Quidditch way up in the sky. It's the little things that make life.
Make life.
And the small mistakes that take life.
Take life.
I'm just trying to make a way getting by.
Getting by.
Till I'm playing Quidditch way up in the sky.
You know I got my eye on the prize. I mean eye on the thighs. I mean I'm supersized. I mean but I work on it. Anger issues stemming from when we were hurt as kids. Sometimes I laugh and I hurt my ribs.
I do.
Sometimes I cry and a headache hits.
I do.
Mama said too much of anything is bad for you. And that means money won't fill up the hole, it's sad but true.
It's true.
The first talk to a girl was Rose on Titanic. Sometimes my dreams feel real, but I can't grab it. A nigga stay fly, feel like I'm Aladdin.
I do.
Out here spitting game, trying to find my Jasmine.
I am.
I like pain, it makes me feel something. It's a cold, cold world, and shit is real numbing. When Kanye got back with Drake, I was slightly confused. I smiled when they fell out again, got some healing to do.
It's the little things that make
life. And the small mistakes that take life. I'm just trying to make a way getting by. Till I'm playing Quidditch way up in the sky. It's the little things that make life. And the small mistakes that take life. I'm just trying to make a way getting by. Till I'm playing Quidditch way up in the sky.
6'5", but feeling less than. Expecto Patrol to my depression. Recently I brushed up on investments. Still trying to make the BET Awards guest list.
You know I got my eye on the prize. We all gonna play that Quidditch game in the sky. You know I got my eye on the prize. We all gonna play that Quidditch game in the sky. We all gonna play that Quidditch game in the sky.
Michael,
you know I got my eye on the prize.